Hi, it's Gadget UK here again. As you can see, this time I'm looking at a Famicom. It's a bit battered, got a bit of a scratch there. You know, it's obviously very yellowed. Someone's chopped off the second controller there. But yeah, hopefully I should be able to get this one working. I've got a few of these actually, I've got five. Three more still on the way. This is the second one. Again, you can see, you know, these have suffered some damage here on the buttons and things on the front here. It's got a crack there, it's got a crack there. But in general, I'm hoping to get some of these working and certainly, you know, be able to use them for some spares. The control pads aren't quite as bad on this one. That looks, yeah, that's not too bad actually, that second player fascia. Yeah, that one's missing. But I mean, you can always put an aftermarket one on there. And like I say, I'm not going to get all of these working. Maybe one or two might be spares out of five, I'm not sure. It depends on the nature of the faults. You know, if we've got like CPU and PPU faults spread across, you know, these five different Famicoms, that's going to dictate how many of the units I can actually get up and running. You can see straight away there's a problem with the power switch on this one, actually. So I'm hoping it's something simple like, you know, the power switch is just broken or something like that. Got a bit of dirt in the slot there, I need to clean that out. But yeah, I'll get the lid off this one first. Once I've looked at what's going on with the switch here. So I disconnected the boards there, I've unscrewed them. Should be able to pull these out now. You'll have seen this all before actually in the previous video that I did when I got one of these before. So you can see, oh god, it's in the right state, needs cleaning up. Seriously, needs cleaning up. But if I just move this out of the way, the power switch, you can see, is still in here. So it's like the head has been snapped off or something, I think. So we'll just unscrew these two screws here to get the switch out. Yeah, so not sure what's happened there. It might have had an impact or something, but you know, the contacts appear to be missing from the inside of it. It's just like a piece of plastic that slides up and down. So yeah, there's no chance of being able to fix that. But what I might be able to do is use the metal part here and put another switch on the underside or something. I'll have to see if I've got anything similar size. But just for now, I can just take these wires off, join them together, and then that should, you know, power it up, obviously, once I've connected the power. But I'll clean it all up first as well as showing out those two wires, and then I'll test it on RF. So after a really brief clean-up of the board there, you can see it's still really dirty, but you know, I managed to get all the dirt out from between the contacts and things. There's still a fair bit of dirt down here and still a fair bit around the crystal and some of those components there. But I've got power connected, got my RF lead. Bearing in mind, as I said in the previous video, it's NTSC-J, so the audio's on a different carrier frequency or something, so I'm not going to get audio. But as you can see, that's working. I've got the sound on. You can hear it get a bomb. I don't think we should get any sound. Try and start it. I've knocked the cart now. Let me just reconnect the power again. Power connection's not making a brilliant fit, but if it start, you can see that works. Just see if I can move the player. Surprisingly, this controller works really well actually. I'm struggling to reach it. Yeah, at left, right, kick, punch, jump, duck. Right, so yeah, it's working fine. Obviously the picture's really shit quality, but by the time I do the composite mod to that, and get the sound coming out there as well, it should be pretty good actually. I just need to spend some time cleaning the board up and find a permanent solution for this switch. You can see I've just bypassed it for the moment, because obviously, like I said, that's just doing nothing. So I think we'll connect this one up next, and see whether this one shows any signs of life just as is. So we're getting a white screen with this one now. It might just be a dirty cartridge slot. Could also be, like I said, faulty PPU perhaps, or VRAM, or even faulty CPU. We'll just try it a few times. Yeah, it's not looking good, is it? It doesn't look like there's some sort of fault on this one. So I'll take the lid off this one, have a quick look at the board, and I'll do some temperature checks, just see if anything's getting, you know, hot, etc. So I've got the back off. Something interesting's been going on with this connector here. I don't know if you can see the interlink here. I think those are probably just two ground connections, but they're joined together with a very large blob of solder there. So someone has been inside this at some point, I think. I don't think that's would have been like that from manufacturing. It could have been. It's just weird that the two join together. I'll just compare to the other one just to make sure they are supposed to be joined, but pretty sure they are. No, they're not. Those are not supposed to be joined together. Now, I could be wrong, but I suspect the SRAM on this one, actually. I'll see how close I can get without blurring it. If you just look at the pins here on this SRAM, you see it's like corroded. It's the same with the one up here as well. So it's not like corrosion's got in there. These SRAMs, they tend, I don't know if they leak internally. I don't know if they've got some sort of electrolytic type stuff going on. I've said that before, actually, on the C64 videos, because I've seen exactly the same thing in SRAMs and C64s, where you get corrosion all around the SRAM, nowhere else. The board's absolutely immaculate. And lo and behold, you know, like I said, the SRAM's usually dead. You swap it out and it's usually alright. So I suspect that's probably what's wrong with this one. But yeah, I'll get the logic probe on there and we'll just see if we get any signs of activity. Might even get the logic analyzer onto one of these just to go through the sort of boot process there, you know, connected up to the address bus and the data bus, and just see if we can demonstrate perhaps the first number of instructions and things being processed. You've got some corrosion down here as well, just a little bit, but yeah, I suspect those SRAMs actually. I might see if we can find some replacements for these, socket them up, and give that a try. So a bit of change of scenery here actually in the kitchen. My wife's away at the moment, so yeah, some kitchen soldering. Don't tell her, she's not going to be best pleased. But yeah, so we just pull this over. I'm going to have a go at removing the SRAMs from this actually. What I might do, because it's going to be a few weeks at least before I can get all the spare SRAMs which I've ordered, is take these off, but take off the ones off the one with a switch, you know, the one that I showed previously that's working okay. Yeah, I might do that. I might take the working ones off that and put them on here, because I do think it's going to be the SRAMs. Could be wrong, but yeah, I'll get them off and I'll show you up close the corrosion on the pins on both chips actually. On the sort of fourth pin from the right hand side here, and I think right from the right hand side of this one here. No corrosion anywhere else on the board, but yeah, I thought it might be interesting just to, I'll show you part of the removal here. I'm not going to show me desoldering the whole thing, but we'll just zoom in here and I'll just show you removing a bit of the solder off some of the pins. So I had to get a bit of WD-40 into my desolder pump there actually, because this thing is just not working at all. There you go, can you see the solder's been removed from there without an issue. So it's just a case, like I say, just adding a bit of solder and flux and just working your way around each of the pins on here. The power plane and ground plane typically take a little bit more heat, more often than not. I'm trying to see one, I think there's one here, I think this one here is like ground or the VCC rail or something. You can see there's a big copper trace leading into it. So we'll just give that a little bit longer heat. Yeah, it's going to take a few attempts, I think. Sorry, the line's not very good. There you go, you can see I've moved that. So I'll just work my way around that chip, get that chip off, do the same with the other one, which I think's here. And then I might just take the ones off that other board, as I say, just to quickly be able to test this and swap it over and see if it works. So there you go, you can see I've got the chip off. Just add a bit of extra light here. Can you see all that discoloration, especially near the you know, the pin up near this top corner here on the PCB? It's I move the torch around a bit, you can see like something's leaked onto the board, and it's just come out of where, you know, those pins were. If I just show you the chip here, if I can get it in the right light here, it looks a bit cleaner. It was this side here. Can you see there's some corrosion on that top pin? From heating it, obviously some of that corrosion's come off, so it looks alright on that side. On the other side, if I can find it, where's it gone now? Am I on the right side? It's on the other side. Flip it around. Can you see those three pins there? Look at the state of the tops of those. But there's nothing else inside the unit anywhere. It's just these two SRAMs. So I think it's not coincidence. I don't think you know, some liquid's leaked in from the top. I do think that these SRAMs have failed. You can see on the tops there, it's looking pretty shot. So here we go, that's the second chip off. So, and it's important to note a few things with this actually. One of these obviously is going to be the work RAM, so it's going to be used by the CPU. Which one's the CPU? Forget which one's which now. That's a PPU. So one of them is used by the PPU, one's used by the CPU. I'm not sure which one of those is which actually at this stage, but you can see again some discoloration on the board here, like corrosion. You might even find, or I might even find, after I've cleaned this off, it might be alright, but I doubt it. I mean, if you look at the state of the one I just took off, can you see the corrosion on the tops of those pins? I think that side's alright. Yeah, it's just what I've seen that before. It's a telltale sign with these SRAMs on the pin on this corner here. It's a telltale sign that they've leaked. And you might not think they've got anything in there to leak out, but I did some research on SRAMs trying to understand what this stuff was that causes, you know, that leaks out and corrodes C64s in the same way, you know, the SRAMs on those, the 2114s or whatever they are. And apparently they do have some electrolytic stuff inside there, in something called the storage trench. So, yeah, I suspect that's what it is. Now, that technology probably moved on, you know, newer SRAMs and stuff, you know, that even just a year or two later after these were manufactured, they might have changed the techniques, which is why you don't tend to see this very much on SRAMs, but you do see it on the 2114s and 2115s. I'm not sure why. I'm doing this gently because what you don't want to do is snag a pad or a trace, you know, and rip it. But yeah, that's come up pretty clean actually. So just getting the second chip off the working board actually here. I just want to show you a technique. Once you've desoldered them, just flick them. If you just listen to this, you just flick the end. And it flicks, just very lightly. And if it doesn't do that, as you'll find when I get towards the end, hang on. Not a lot, you don't want to bend them. That one's stuck. So I'll desolder that a bit more. That one's alright. Just go around and just do this until you're sure both. You know, it's desoldered on both sides. In fact, you've got enough sufficient solder off on the sides of the pin there to allow you to freely flick it. If you can't, you see that one can't either. So I think we've got the one up there to do, and one down here. So those are the two working chips. I'll stick them onto this board now. So apologies, it's really dark in here. I'll show you some more in the daylight once I've cleaned up, but this is the faulty board, you know, the one that's giving sort of like either a white or a grey screen. I've swapped the SRAMs over, pointing the screen, and as you will see, that has fixed the problem. So it was a RAM problem, and you can see, I don't know, you can see, even though it's dark in here, you should be able to see, you know, this is the one with the two controllers, the other one had the one cut off, and this is the one with a good power switch where you can switch it off and on. But yeah, I'm pleased with that because that means that, you know, obviously the CPU and PPU are fine on this one. I'll see if I can start this. Yeah, there we go, that's working fine. Obviously I can't test the sound until I get the sound wired up and stuff, but yeah, that's really good. So you've seen me clean controllers 100 times before. I'll just briefly show you some of the things for people who've perhaps not seen some of my earlier videos. You can see it's been cracked or something there, I think, and glued potentially. I don't know, but we'll take these apart and have a look inside, clean up the exteriors. The second one's not too bad here. It's just a shame the fascia's missing. But then again, it looks a lot more presentable than some of them do. You know, like if you look at the one I did in my last video, the one I've kept for myself, it's you know, pretty scratched up, my player one controller. And you can get, as I said in that video, you can get replacement fascias. They're not the same as this one. They've got like either themed like Mario or Zelda, etc. But yeah, I could always get some of those for this. So the screw heads are pretty worn actually, and if you put a you know, a Phillips, you know, cross head on there, it's just slipping because they're corroded. So if you put a flat blade, I've just got a very small flat blade here, that's just wide enough, and put some pressure down on the top part, you know, your thumb, you can see they are coming out, but I would have just chewed up the remainder of the heads, I think, had I continued to try and use that Phillips. Yes, so I've had to alternate between the flat blade and the crosshead here. See that one, it feels like it's making a good fit. The other thing you can do with these, the way they're designed, you know, use your thumb to hold the thing down, obviously put some decent pressure on, and then because it's ridged the side here, just put some pliers and just do a bit of this with the pliers until you've got it sort of starting to freewheel. So it looks like it's just a scratch, that, because as you can see on the inside, it's okay. Look at that screw. No wonder that screw was having trouble coming out there. Look at that. It's at an angle. So, I mean, it has had a knock there, so maybe that is a fracture on the outside. I don't know. It's going to be interesting trying to get that screw out when it's bent like that. Look at that. Yeah, it's probably, it's a case of the port, the pillar there's broken off in that corner. It's strange how the bit of plastic's not in here. You don't expect it to be. But yeah, we'll clean these up. Let's just say, yeah, there you go, you've screwed. But I've got some replacements for these, which I'll show you in a minute. Yeah, so those need replacing. That's probably why someone's been in it. They probably put faulty ones in from something else. Those look alright. Let's have a look at that. Yeah, that needs replacing. You see that? Shot. All of them are shot, actually, all four buttons there. So yeah, those are coming out. So when it comes to getting off all these marks and things, particularly this glue here, soap and water is just not cutting it. You've got to use a bit of IPA. And I might need to get a bit of plastic cleaner on it as well, but as you can see, it is coming off. There you go, you can see the difference after cleaning up with IPA to get the glue off, and then some Plastex here, just to give it this, you know, this nice shine, this polish. It brings the colour up really, really well. So yeah, that top part's actually looking pretty damn good, actually, even without the fascia. So, usual clean, a little pads here, tiny bit of IPA, just wipe it and dry it. Doesn't need a lot, really. It's just about, just let's say, just clean the surface a little bit. If you rub it too hard, you'll get tons of that black stuff coming off, and that's supposed to be there. You don't want to rub that off. You just want to just clean it. And then the same thing with the underneath of these. Bearing in mind, I'm swapping out the other two pieces of silicone, so... Well, the top pieces have come out of the sink. I've actually peeled, you know, this one had the stickers still on, but they were really messy at the top. They'd peeled back and the glue had gone everywhere and the ink had worn off the top parts. So they just looked a state. So I'll use some IPA to clean up the bits there, those black bits you can see. It still looked pretty good, actually. Still got the markings and things on the back there. Those look good. So that's the least yellow of the two. This one's heavily yellowed, as you can see. But it's come out really clean. You know, it's just yellowed. Simple as that, and the labels are obviously in a much better condition on this one, but it's got a scratch, nasty scratch there. Piece of the plastic's actually been scratched, gouged out. So there's a few other things I need to do. You can see sometimes these still look, you know, they've got the red stripe there, but it's yellowed, you know, the things have been affected by ambient light there. So I think the easiest way to deal with that is just get a red permanent marker. And just, you can just colour that whole area in and it should look almost good as new, I think. I'll give that a try. The other one, it's more noticeable on the top's actually come off. Now, it's not come off in the wash, it just wasn't there. You can see it's just like it's faded and it looks like it's been peeled off. Obviously these are wet at the moment, so I need to try those. So I could do something similar to that. I could always just stick a new red stripe on. I might even do that with that one. Take that one off and just stick a new red stripe on. I can always print something. These really need swapping out, or one of them does anyway. This one's got a piece missing, but it still, you know, it still clips in and holds in place. But I don't know why on both of these, you can see they've got some damage on the front there. So and that one's got some glue or something stuck on it, I don't know. Yeah, it's gooey, I think. So I'll clean that up with some IPA to make sure you get all that stuff off the surface. Give that one a bit of a wipe with some IPA, but then I'll use some plastic putty and smooth it over just to make sure that's flat, and then I might just get a piece of red insulation tape and stick it on the front nice and flat, so it'll look okay. We'll have a red stripe of tape there, but it's just to strengthen it more than anything, because yeah, where are you going to get these from? You know, you're just going to have to sacrifice one from another system or something, so at least they should be functional by the time I finish that. So just to show you, even though when you wash these in the sink you think you've got all the dirt off, as soon as you get plastic cleaner on here and go over the edges and things with it, I mean, A, the colour comes up really well, but can you see, because it's slightly dark, it picks up dirt that's actually ingrained into the plastic, but also, you know, like I said, brings back the colour and gets off any bits of dirt. I think there's a bit on one of the sides somewhere. Let's try that side. Yeah, there's a bit there. Can you see that bit of black shit? That'll probably come off with the plastic cleaner, I think. That's almost off, just get a bit more on. So that's player one all reassembled. It's looking pretty clean. It probably just needs a little bit of a clean just here. There's just a couple of bits there that I've not done. Can't do anything with this. It's scratched, you know, it's like that's permanent like scratch and marks, you know. But yeah, with a new fascia, that would look good as new, really. So you can see I'm just testing some anti-static bag there, just to make sure I don't sort of introduce any ESD into the chips there. I'll show you this now. It's working fine. Hang on. Oh, that's demo. Right, there we go. Start. And as I did in the previous video, because I'm using replacement D-pads here, I put a couple of layers of insulation tape stuck onto the D-pad itself so that you can get diagonals like that. No problems at all. Try that in the other direction. Hang on. Let's go that way. Yeah. So without that, those replacement silicons from AliExpress and eBay, they don't, you know, you can't get diagonals, but yeah, diagonals work fine once you just put that little layer of insulation tape. What would be really nice is if someone could perhaps manufacture a clear piece of plastic or something, you know, it's like maybe a half a millimetre thick, to fit around the D-pad there, because that would be like a really nice clean way of using those replacement silicons. But yeah, this method does actually work really well. They feel just as good as the original once you get those two layers of insulation tape on there. I've seen all sorts now. You can see someone's put some aluminium foil or something, perhaps not aluminium, but some foil over there. I think the buttons need swapping out on this one as well. It was a given, really. It was bound to need doing, but it's just interesting someone's glued some metal onto that. I'm not sure why you would need to do that, really, because they don't wear, you know, you just clean them. They don't wear down to the point where there's nothing there. As you can see, you know, it's still got the black stuff underneath. I think because it stopped working, someone's assumed that that's what needed doing, but actually it's this, you know, it's the fact that the buttons come off, you know, it's broken around the circumference. So neither of these first two cases are in great condition. You know, this is the one that's got still got the labels on here, but it's got a scratch there, and this flap, can you see, it's got a nasty scratch. So I think I'll swap the flap over, put a good flap on this one, because this one in general is in better condition. It's just got some marks like that there, even though it's been washed. So a bit of IPA, in fact that's a crack, can you see it's been cracked on the inside. So I'll get some super glue in there and just hold that in place. I'll do it from the inside just to make sure that's glued, but there is a mark there. Yeah, these little black marks, like I said, they'll come off with a bit of IPA. Like that, that's how I'm done. There's a mark back here, clean that off. Yeah, back's a bit dirty here. And it is yellowed, but by the time, and again, some marks here, those will come off with IPA. But by the time I've got a new flap on it, that should be alright, I think. It's got all the stickers and everything, you know, the original stickers and things, all the other ones at the back are a little bit faded. But yeah, I think I'll use that one as the one that I'll perhaps get rid of with, you know, a decent working board and everything, decent set of controllers. And then whatever's left, I'll keep as a spare. So these flaps, I'll show you, I'll put it in, it just sits on one side, and then you just bend it slightly in the middle like that, and it will then fit on the other side. So yeah, pretty easy to swap those over. Still a bit wet, that flap, actually, you can see there's still a bit of water on it. But at least this one's not got the big gouge that the old one had, as you can see there. So the second one's pretty much finished now. I did wash it in the sink, you can see these marks here haven't come off. So just a bit of plastic cleaner here, and I want to show you the difference of how much this makes, actually. I mean, it gets, as you can see, those are coming off straight away there. But as you go over this area here in circles, trying to get on the metalised sort of part there, you'll find it, you know, it really brings back the colour and the shine to the surface, but also gets off any marks like that. As you can see, those are almost gone now, the marks there. It's really good stuff, this Meguiar's Plastics. I love it for cleaning any sort of plastic like this, because it just doesn't leave any scratches or anything, you know. You see that? See how shiny this bit is, and so the colour's sort of different to the rest of it. I'll do the same on the underside as well, just so you can see how much. But I mean, look at the dirt that's come off there as well. Can you see that? Even though it's already been cleaned. So the thing I didn't show in the last video actually is I've got some WD-40 onto this spring here just to wipe off any corrosion. It's not too bad, actually. One of them is really corroded, this one just looks a bit dull. But then get some grease onto the rail, you know, onto the plastic sliders there. So I forget which way this goes, whichever side rubs on the underneath of the cart thing, I think it might be, I think it might be this side. Just get some grease onto here. Yeah, it's the underside here, because this press is on the cart fitting, so it's just a case of, like I said, just getting a bit of grease on here. And I think it only needs to go so far. It's just that it makes a squeaking noise otherwise, as you get plastic on plastic. And you don't need masses of this, it's just a case of just distributing it and making sure it's covering the surface there. That should do, I think. So with a bit of red permanent marker, you can see that looks good as new. So I've shown all this before, but just a quick look, because I didn't really show at different stages in the last video. So you need to remove all these components where you can see these nice clean pads here. So there's quite a few. And then I've got a 220 microfarad cap, your positive goes from here, and your negative goes across to there. And then we just need a resistor, I'll show you that in a minute. So the other thing you need to do is remove the 2K2 and put a 200 ohm resistor there. Remove the 220 ohm resistor from here and put a wire link across there. So just a close up here on these faulty SRAMs. I think the NES, you've got the same chips here, this, you know, there will be two of them again, but I think both of them are wider, the wider type. One of them might not be, I can't remember without looking back at my old video there. And an interesting side note, actually, while I'm here as well, I might, with some of these Famicoms I've got coming, I might take a PPU and CPU out, put them in my PAL system and convert it to US. I think the only other thing I need to do is change the crystal. But yeah, I mean, you can see, you know, the corrosion down here. That was the telltale sign there was something wrong with that. And it's the same with this one. And there's definitely nothing leaked onto the board. It's come from within the chip itself, as you can see, some of the pins there and up here as well. So yeah, that's definitely those are definitely shots. I think what I'll do though is when the other Famicoms arrive and I've got ordered a load of these spare chips, I'll socket, I mean I've probably damaged them with ESD now handling this way, but I'll test them anyway independently, because that's one thing I haven't done. One of these might work whereas the other doesn't, but I seriously doubt it. I think they both failed in the same way. Like I say, I think they both had something leak from inside the some sort of electrolyte, I think, that's as I mentioned earlier, that's used in these old SRAMs, because I've seen exactly the same thing before on C64s. So final stages with this one, 47 cap there from VCC to ground. There's just an additional bit of smoothing as per my last video. You can see the resistor up here, 120 ohm, just from the, across that connection there to feed to the video out. So that's where you, you know, your composite now goes into your RF. You can see I've got a little fly lead here on the back for audio out, and that just goes, sorry, I zoomed a bit too close there, just goes between ground, your nearest point for ground is up here, and pin 46, it's marked 45 on the board there, so you know your audio out is the pin next to it. And that's it, it's been recapped as well. Sometimes on these the sockets, you know, the DC jack here needs replaced on the back, but the one on this one's okay. So, and I did sort of kind of clean this up a little bit. It still looks a bit of a mess because someone swapped out the you know, the back modulator and power board here, and they soldered it on the top. Now I could have soldered it from the other side, but I removed the, there was a bit of like chopped off cable on the other side, I removed that, started trying to feed it through, but realized these wires are not really that long, they're not long enough, and it's just really fiddly to do. So I just put it back as it was. It still looks a bit, just pretty much like it did, really a bit of a mess, but I have cleaned up with some IPA there. So I think that one's good to reassemble. It's all done, we can test it. It's all connected up here. You can see I've got video coming into the RF point and the audio coming out the fly lead there. And if I point you with the screen, we'll see that's working. Let's just start the game. Got this controller leads us short. There we go. And one thing to note actually, after adding that 47 microfarad cap, the additional one, it's the picture's a bit cleaner. The band in there, you can just see on the blues, it's not quite as bad as it was. So that's interesting. Last time you see, I don't think I noticed that, but yeah, it definitely tidied up the picture just a tiny little bit. Now these levers, the ones I've got are all got massive chunks smashed down the middle. So I've been filling them with some plastic putty, and then if I use some plastic polish, all of this excess, you know, the excess bits around the edges here, this will all just polish off, including the bit on the top there, and just leave that white bit in the middle. There's a couple of options then. You could actually, you know, spray it or something, you know, paint it. The other possibilities, I might just get some red PVC tape and stick a piece on the front and just on the top there, so it's not going to look exactly the same colour, but it'll look nice and tidy and presentable, and it's not going to smash because, you know, it's right in the centre. You know, it goes right in the centre of that thing, so it could break really easily if you don't do something there. But yeah, there's not much more you can do with that really, other than, let's say, maybe spray it and or just replace it. This particular one's got a missing piece on that side, but I've done the same with the other ones as well. So in preparation of SRAM arriving for this working board, because if you remember, this is the one that I'd asked SRAM on there, it was just the power switch that was the problem. So this board works. I've done the composite mod to this, you know, I've got the audio fly lead coming out the back here. I've done the capacitor mod, you know, various things. You could say, added the extra cap there. Removed all the components, just the same as the other one. So it's just a case of just testing this now. I really should be doing this on a proper mat rather than this tiny bit of ESD bag here. One thing I forgot to mention in the previous video, that these two 40368s, I think, these are for the inputs. So if you ever have problems with the controls on these, that's your first port of call. Well, other than obviously just, you know, general connectivity, making sure the connections are coming in into the pins here, then they should hit these chips and ultimately be read by the CPU, I think. The interesting thing with this one, and I didn't mention it before, but it's got this like heat sink, an aluminium heat sink or something on the top of it, with the 2C02E stamped on top of it. So yeah, I've never seen that before. That's interesting. Whether they added that to some of the later PPUs or not, I'm not sure. Still a bit dirty, this board. I've cleaned up most of it. There's still just a bit of dirt around here that I can't get out because it's in such small crevices and things. So I'll have another go at that later when the SRAM arrives. I think I'm going to socket up the SRAM. I don't think there's enough space to stick a socket there, just because of, you know, once it's inside the case, I think there's a piece of plastic, you know, that goes around the cartridge that sort of comes down to pretty much level with these chips here. But here you can have a socket, so I'll probably stick a socket there and then, you know, just solder one in there. But that'll allow me to use this as a test board, really, just to test RAM chips, SRAMs in there that way, you know, using that socket, because I think there should be sufficient space, like I said, for a socket there. I need to double check, but yeah, I think there is. So I connected up there now. I thought there's value in just showing you what happens when you've got no SRAM. You just get a grey screen. So if you ever get a NES or a Famicom that gives you a grey screen, your SRAM, particularly the program SRAM, is most likely going to be your course. I mean, obviously on the NES, the first thing you need to check before that really is the slots, you know, because it's always the cart slot on those on the, you know, the PAL and the US NES. But the Famicom, yeah, you get a grey screen, it's going to be a RAM fault. Could be a CPU fault, but 9 times out of 10 it's going to be an SRAM fault. Anyway, I thought you'd find that interesting. Thanks for watching. I'll see you soon.